Okay. So I'm going to cover real quick that induced responses worksheet that everybody turned in. So the first part is answering this question. The correct answer to this is B. So only animals have a nervous system. That is something that is unique to animals. And so you can see on this phylogenetic tree here, this represents all animals. So you've got this group sponges here, which is the sort of the most simple type of animal. Then you've got this group, the cnidarians, jellyfish, corals, and sea anemones. And then you've got this group called the bilaterians. That's things like vertebrates and insects, flatworms, and other animals. And you can see here that a nervous system is something that's unique to this particular animal group. It's a synapomorphy that divides these animal groups. And so only animals have a nervous system. And a nervous system is basically a system of neurons and synapses that allow animals to respond to things super, super, super quickly. Like it spreads at the speed of electricity almost. And so the idea that animals can move around really quickly, that whole movement and things like that that's unique to animals depends on having this nervous system that can send and transmit signals super, super quickly. So just to be clear, only animals have a nervous system. And this diagram here is just all these different types of animals, and the yellow stuff represents the nervous system that's running through them. All the yellow stuff represents nerves. All right. Next question. The correct answer for this one is D, all of the above. So plants, animals, and fungi all use hormones to basically transmit signals throughout their body. So these are just a couple examples that I've put up. I wouldn't expect you to memorize these examples. The main thing I want you to pull from this is that all these groups use hormones to transmit signals. So in plants, they can use these things called auxins and cytokinins. In humans, there's tons of different hormones that we have. Insulin is just one example that we can use to regulate blood sugar levels. And we also have fungi that use hormones for tons of different things related to growth, sex, food acquisition, so many different things. And so hormones is a universal transmission system to spread signals in organisms. Next question. B is the correct answer. This is a false statement. So remember that an adaptation is a heritable trait that enhances fitness. An induced trait is not heritable. Okay, so the ability to respond and all those associated receptors, transducers, transmission systems, those are all heritable. But that non-permanent trait that arises from the response is not passed on. So let me just give you a silly example here. Crazy tan lady still has pale kids, okay? So if we look at crazy tan lady, what's the induced trait that we're talking about here in crazy tan lady? That's exactly right, her tan, okay? And so to make this perfectly clear, that tan that she got, it's not a heritable trait. So she won't pass that tan off to her offspring. Her ability to tan is heritable, and that ability can be passed on, and it will spread through a population if it confers some type of fitness. But the induced trait itself, that tan, does not get passed on. So it's important to make that distinction. And so if we apply this to the other example that we talked about with plants raised in dark versus light and having this sort of response to the amount of light in terms of how long these nodes are and how big the leaves are, where you get longer nodes and smaller leaves if you're raised in a dark environment because the plant's trying to reach up for that light. So this plant that's raised in dark is not going to produce offspring with longer nodes and smaller leaves. That induced trait is not going to be passed to its offspring. So that dark phenotype with longer nodes and smaller leaves itself is not heritable, but that ability to adapt to light is heritable, and that trait can be passed on, okay? So once again, you're making this distinction between the change in phenotype versus the ability to change your phenotype. Okay, so what's the explanation for why many responses are inducible as opposed to turned on constantly? So why have these sort of traits that can change, yet they're not passed on. Only that ability to change is passed on. And use an example to demonstrate your point. So I'm going to show you guys a very sort of straightforward example of this, where you can think about a puffer fish, okay? So this is the puffer fish when it's not inflated. This is the puffer fish when it's inflated. And you can think about the benefits of being inflated. You can ward off predators. If you're some type of predator that wants to come and eat this puffer fish, it's going to be super tough to wrap your mouth around that. And it's going to be super spiky when you do. You're not going to want to eat that puffer fish. However, if this puffer fish is always blown up, it's really tough for it to swim around and eat prey itself, right? And so it's super handy for it to be able to deflate, because now it can swim much faster and it can catch other prey itself, all right? So the point here is that there's a cost and a benefit to being blown up all the time. And so it's nice to be able to have this inducible trait where you can kind of turn it on and turn it off, all right? And so I asked for the general conditions that be necessary for an inducible response to be selected for. The very sort of most general conditions where you would have an inducible response be selected for. And there's a ton of things that you guys could have written for this, but in general, what I'm looking for in terms of the conditions for it to be selected for is that the benefits in terms of fitness of having that inducible response outweigh the costs of having that inducible response. When I talk about fitness, I'm talking about the successful offspring that are produced. Fitness is the amount of offspring that you produce in the next generation. And if you think about this and flip it on its head, what are the general conditions necessary for an inducible response to be selected against? Basically, the costs outweigh the benefits. So if it's more expensive to have this inducible response, if it's energetically expensive to be puffing up and shrinking all the time, then that inducible response and the ability to have that inducible response is going to be selected against. So this is the idea of an evolutionary trade-off. Okay, so when we're talking about evolutionary trade-offs, I asked you guys to use examples from those accumulated responses to provide examples of the costs and benefits of inducible responses. And basically what I'm looking for here, for any inducible response, at some point it's going to be energetically expensive. That's going to those energetic expenses are going to result in reduced growth and survival potentially, which can result in reduced reproduction and overall decreased fitness. However, on the other hand, if these inducible responses increase survival and growth, they increase reproduction, they're going to increase fitness, okay? And so the idea here is that by making responses inducible instead of always turned on, so having the ability to puff up versus shrink down as opposed to always being puffed up, can help reduce some of these energetic expenses. And therefore, you can have selection for this inducible response. So let's look at this in another context. So let's look at a plant raised in nutrient-rich soils versus a plant raised in nutrient-poor soils. And this idea of an evolutionary trade-off for the sort of types of inducible responses that might be selected for in one environment and not in the other. Okay, so in nutrient-rich soils, there's this general hypothesis that plants should invest more resources into growth and fewer resources in defense, with the prediction being that if you put all of your resources into growth, growth alone will outpace any herbivory. And basically herbivory is just, you know, caterpillars and things like that eating away at the plant. So even if you have predators eating away at the plant and the leaves, like you see here in this picture right here, this plant can say, I don't care if I get eaten a lot, I can just invest all my resources in growth and I can just outgrow the rate that I'm getting eaten. Whereas if you're in nutrient poor soils, so a different habitat type, you have this general hypothesis that plants are going to invest resources into defense. So they're actually going to divert some of those resources that are initially put into growth and put some of those resources into defense. And fewer resources, therefore, are going to be invested into growth, with the general prediction being that growth alone in this nutrient-poor environment can't outpace herbivory or the rate that the plant's getting eaten. And so these plants need to invest in defenses. So we can actually put together an experiment to test these hypotheses and predictions. So here's an example of that experiment. Basically, what you're looking at are changes in plant mass over time in a couple different treatments that are here on the x-axis. So you've got your response variable here. This is our dependent variable. And then we've got our independent variables down here at the bottom. So these are the things that we're sort of manipulating. And we're seeing what are the effects of this manipulation on changes in plant mass. And then we've got two different plant types. We've got plants that are from a high nutrient environment and plants from a low nutrient environment. And basically what we're looking at is what happens if we take plants from a high nutrient environment and plants from a low nutrient environment, and we move them from the environments that they grew up in and put them into an only high nutrient environment where there's herbivores around that can eat those plants. And so what we see here is if these are in a high nutrient environment, those plants that were initially from a high nutrient environment that are investing more resources into growth are outgrowing those plants that are diverting some of those resources to defenses. And so we have more growth here. And so there should be selection for these plants. But if we look at, so plants that invest resources toward growth instead of defense do better in nutrient-rich environments with predators. That's the sort of take-home here. But if we put these same plants into a low nutrient environment in the presence of predators, we see that the plants from a low nutrient environment do much, much better. So they grow much better, whereas those plants that are investing in growth but not defenses are not growing as well. And so in other words, plants that invest resources towards defense instead of growth do better in a nutrient-poor environment with predators. So the savvy student or the skeptical scientist might say, okay, but is this change in growth because of the predator? So do we see this happening because this predator's here? Or do we see this happening because there's low nutrients around and there's just something else going on with this plant that allows it to grow well in a low nutrient environment? And so you can do a second set of experiments where let's take the predator completely away and then grow these same plants in high nutrients and in low nutrients. And what you'll see here is in this case, when the herbivores are removed, plants that invest in resources towards growth instead of defense, so these plants from a high nutrient environment, do better in both cases. So what is this telling us? Basically, it's telling us that fitness is context dependent, okay? So low nutrient plants do much better with predators and low nutrient availability. And so you'll have selection for investment in this inducible response. More investment in defenses, less investment in growth. Whereas in all of these other habitats, if you reduce investment in defenses and increase investment or the ability to have a sort of more sensitive response to nutrients and investing more in growth, you're going to do much better. And so the take home here is that inducible responses and really any trait can be selected for in one environment and against in another environment. So you may be asking yourself, that's all well and great, Dr. Hyman, but what the hell am I supposed to actually know for this? So this is what you're supposed to actually know. Poll question. D is the correct answer. So inducible responses are just like any other trait. They're going to be selected for when the fitness-related benefits, so remember when we're talking about fitness, we're talking about production of offspring. When the benefits in terms of offspring produced outweigh the costs. So energetic benefits can be part of that, and those can affect your fitness, but ultimately all we care about is the fitness. Sarah asked, would it be not be both B and D? So the most correct answer is D. And on top of that, B says energetic benefits outweigh the energetic benefits. So maybe you could be right, Sarah, if it said energetic costs here, but it doesn't say costs here. But ultimately, what we care about in the end is fitness. And in fact, sometimes Sometimes energetic benefits, even if they do outweigh the energetic costs, they still don't affect your fitness at all. And so you could have this case, but it still doesn't affect fitness. So it's not technically correct. Okay, next set of poll questions. So let's go through these piece by piece. Responses may be selected for in one environment, but against in another. That is a true statement. We've given several examples of why that's true. Temporary traits that arise from responses are adaptations that can be passed on to future generations. That is a false statement, just like Tan Lady doesn't pass on that temporary tan to her future generation. Thorns on a rosebush are an example of a constitutive response. That is a true statement. So thorns on a rosebush, they don't sort of grow or extend themselves in response to predators or whatever it is. They're either there or they're not. So they're an example of a constitutive response. And both plants and animals have evolved neurons as a way to transmit signals. That is a false statement. Neurons are part of a nervous system, a central nervous system, and they are unique to animals. Both plants and animals use hormones, as do fungi, but only animals have neurons. Okay, so why should you care at all about induced responses? Well, let's watch a video and talk about that.
A warthog is not often sort of wallowing in the sort of anxiety that we think of in an everyday sense. And if you're a warthog, pretty much what anxiety is about is seeing a lion at the end of the field, so you better be vigilant.
The warthog's amygdala, the emotional center of the brain, identifies the lion as a threat, and that triggers the release of adrenaline throughout the body.
This is a brush fire of vigilance.
It prepares the body to face the threat and fight, or to flee. The warthog's heart is racing, and breathing speeds up. Lung passages expand, and certain blood vessels dilate, all to make sure plenty of oxygen gets to the muscles needed to flee. Those muscles tense, ready for action. The warthog's pupils dilate so its eyes can take in more of the scene. And then its peripheral vision shrinks to focus on the lion in front of it. Other systems get shut down.
You got better things to do with your energy than digest breakfast or worry about reproduction or something like that.
The warthog stops salivating and digesting. Blood flow is diverted away from the stomach, away from the skin, and nerves involved in arousal get turned off.
Everything that's going on in his body at the time is wonderfully adaptive.
Anxiety evolved as a helpful emotion. It has prepared the warthog to escape with its life. This time. If you're a warthog, there's a pretty good chance you'll eventually be killed by a lion. But if you're a human, you're probably worried about other things.
We're smart enough to mobilize the exact same physiology as does that warthog seeing a lion at the other end of the field, and we do it worrying about the 30-year mortgage we just signed on for. Oh no, only 3 months until April 15th and paying taxes, or oh no, how many more decades of this or that, or oh no, this traffic jam is horrible.
Or oh no, that exam's coming in 3 days.
Is we're filled with fear, we're filled with distress, we're filled with anxiety, and what your body is doing is every perfect adaptation to send energy to your thigh muscles to run for your life.
You can't fight or flee your taxes or traffic. But our body wants to respond just like a warthog when it sees a lion. Think of the symptoms of stress. Racing heart, tense muscles, stomach aches, a feeling of pins and needles, dry mouth, not wanting to or being able to have sex. All very familiar. The amygdalas of humans with severe anxiety are overly sensitive. They identify threats in everyday situations and set off this adrenaline chain reaction. People with clinical anxiety see the world differently. In one study,
So that's a great example of an induced response and hormones and how they can affect us. And I mean, if you're like me at all, I'm a very, very anxious person. It's just interesting to understand how that sort of has evolved and also gone a bit out of control in modern day society. And this sort of idea of hormones having a big role in our own personal lives comes across not only in anxiety, but in so many places, such that, you know, drug companies and doctors spend a lot of time developing ways to manipulate our hormones to do things that, you know, we want it to do, or behave in ways that we want it to behave, whether it's controlling anxiety, depression, addiction, birth control, hormone therapy. All of these ideas come from, or all of these sort of tools that we have in medicine come from this idea of controlling these signaling systems that we have in hormones. So it's interesting to think about how this idea of induced responses and all the sort of receptors that we've evolved over time can be used both in beneficial ways, but also